St. Patrick. Tomorrow is Spaghetti to Go Sunday. Drive a walk through from 11 a.m. to 2 p.m. at the parish center. Don't forget, order some extra meatballs or sauce. Our next Parish Activities Committee meeting will be 6 p.m. Tuesday, April 20th. All are invited to attend the meeting, and don't forget to bring along your ideas to help make us a better parish. Time to get your foursome together for our annual parish golf outing, Saturday, May 22nd at Hidden Valley Golf Course. Additional information can be found in the bulletin. St. Patrick's Preschool is now accepting registrations for the 2021-2022 school year. Check the bulletin for more information. All three readings show the transformative power of belief in Jesus' resurrection. St. John tells us that we become children of God through this belief. Thomas acknowledges Jesus as the Lord and God in the Gospel, and he and the other apostles want to create an ideal community by proclaiming his resurrection in Jerusalem. We remember at this Mass Clara and John Zelensky. Our presider is Monsignor O'Connor. Please stand and join in the opening prayer.
Brothers and sisters, let us acknowledge our sins and so prepare ourselves to celebrate the sacred mysteries.
You were sent to heal the contrite of heart. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
You came to call sinners. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
You are seated at the right hand of the Father to intercede for us. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
Thank you.
God of everlasting mercy, who in the very occurrence of the Paschal Feast kindle the faith of the people you have made your own, increase, we pray, the grace you have bestowed, that all may grasp and rightly understand in what font they have been washed, by whose spirit they have been reborn, by whose blood they have been redeemed. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God, forever and ever. Amen.
A reading from the Acts of the Apostles. The community of believers was of one heart and mind, and no one claimed that any of his possessions was his own, but they had everything in common. With great power, the apostles bore witness to the resurrection of the Lord Jesus, and great favor was accorded to them all. There was no needy person among them, for those who owned property or houses would sell them, bring the proceeds of the sale, and put them at the feet of the apostles, and they were distributed to each according to need. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
reading from the first letter of St. John. Beloved, everyone who believes that Jesus is the Christ begotten by God, and everyone who loves the Father loves also the one begotten by him. In this way we know that we love the children of God, when we love God and obey his commandments. For the love of God is this, that we keep his commandments, and his commandments are not burdens. For whoever is begotten by God conquers the world, and the victory that conquers the world is our faith. Who indeed is the victor over the world but the one who believes that Jesus is the Son of God? This is the one who came through water and blood, Jesus Christ, not by water alone, but by water and blood. The Spirit is the one that testifies, and the Spirit is truth. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Jesus came and stood in their midst and said to them, "Peace be with you." When he had said this, he showed them his hands and his side. The disciples rejoiced when they saw the Lord. Jesus said to them again, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, so I send you." And when he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit. Whose sins you forgive are forgiven them, and whose sins you retain are retained." Thomas, called Didymus, one of the 12, was not with them when Jesus came. So the other disciples said to him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the mark of the nails in his hands, and put my finger into the nail marks, and put my hand into his side, I will not believe." Now, a week later, his disciples were again inside, and Thomas was with them. Jesus came, although the doors were locked, and stood in their midst and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here and see my hands, and bring your hand and put it into my side. And do not be unbelieving, but believe." Thomas answered and said to him, "My Lord and my God." Jesus said to him, "Have you come to believe because you have seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen and have believed." Now Jesus did many other signs in the presence of his disciples that are not written in this book. But these are written that you may come to believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that through this belief you may have life in his name. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Thank you.
celebrate today the second Sunday of Easter, or the culmination of the octave of Easter, for we have been, as a church, celebrating Easter Sunday for this entire week. The octave encompasses the day of Easter, and to commemorate and to meditate upon what this means. And of course, today, through the pontificate of St. John Paul II, has been renamed also as Divine Mercy Sunday, and as we have over in that side of the church, the statue of the Divine Mercy, right beside the statue of St. John Paul II. He named this Sunday Divine Mercy after the revelations to Sister Faustina, St. Faustina, of the Divine Mercy of Almighty God. And as the opening prayer indicated today, that mercy is everlasting. And that mercy is today given into the hands of the apostles on this second Sunday of Easter in the Gospel, on the first day of the week, when Jesus appeared to them, breathed on them, and said, "Receive the Holy Spirit." It's very interesting to take a look at this resurrection account in the Gospel of St. John. There are many similarities in the Gospel accounts, in all four versions of the Gospel. But St. John's Gospel, in many ways, follows the themes from the book of Genesis. And so you notice that John begins his theological reflection on the resurrection and telling the story, saying, "On the evening of that first day of the week, God created on the first day, and on the second day, and so on and so forth." And the resurrection is the new creation. The old order created the world, but sin and selfishness absorbed the people of the earth, and they turned away in many ways from the commands of God. But Jesus, in his passion, death, and resurrection, which we are celebrating in this Easter season, created us anew, restored us in our relationship with Almighty God. And that's really what divine mercy is all about. The Gospel of John tells us today that as Jesus appeared to the apostles, now you can just imagine this scene for a moment. You can imagine, place yourself in the footsteps, in the feet, in the shoes, the sandals of the apostles. They have witnessed the terrible death of Christ, the torturous crucifixion. They are hiding in seclusion out of fear that they might be next, that those who crucified Jesus might come after them. And all of a sudden, in that locked room, Jesus is there. Now, you can imagine, perhaps, the shock of seeing the risen Christ and what they thought he might say to them. You know, they did run away. They did betray him. They did deny him. And they all, except John, ran away in Jesus' greatest moment of need. So you might think they would have expected to be chastised by the Lord for their behavior, but no, that's not what Jesus says to them. He says, "Peace be with you." Now that word peace is not just the meaning of the absence of war. In the Jewish construct, that peace would really be translated in this fashion: may all good things be yours. May everything good be yours. May everything that you need be with you. May all be well with you. And Jesus says that. Peace be with you. The very essence of divine mercy, of forgiveness
And then he breathes on them and says, receive the Holy Spirit, the Ruach, the breath of God. Whose sins you forgive will be forgiven. Whose sins you hold bound will be held bound. The very core of divine mercy that we know in the sacrament of reconciliation by the forgiveness of our sins. That's really what this mission is all about. And then it goes on to tell us that Jesus shows them his wounds. That's a pretty common theme in all the versions of the resurrection, that the risen Christ keeps the marks of his passion on him. It is said of the Spanish mystic, Saint Teresa of Avila, Carmelite mystic from Spain, that once the devil appeared to her in the form of the risen Christ, but she knew he was a fake. And she dismissed him, get out of here. And it is said that as the evil one was leaving, he said to her, well, how did you know I was a fake? And she said, because you don't have the wounds of the crucifixion on you. The risen Lord keeps those wounds as a continuous sign to us of what has taken place. That we have been forgiven in the mercy of God by the passion, death, and resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. They're the signs of the Paschal mystery. What a loving God, what a merciful God, what a life-giving God we have. And as we continue to celebrate the season of the resurrection, we recognize and renew our own faith that has been given to us, that all of us are the recipients of that mercy. All of us are reconciled by Christ to God the Father. May we continue to celebrate with great joy this season of life, of hope, of resurrection.
I believe in one God, Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God,
Lord of God,
for all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial to the Father. For him all things were made, for us men and for our salvation. And by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary, who became man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again before you to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son is the Lord and glorified, and has spoken through the prophets.
I believe in
one Catholic and Apostolic Church.
I confess
my baptism for forgiveness of sins. And I look forward to the resurrection today. Christ is risen, and the power of his resurrection fills the world today with new life. With hope and expectation, let us therefore bring him all our needs and the needs of the world.
That our Pope Francis and all bishops, priests, and deacons will boldly and faithfully proclaim the resurrection of Christ to those who do not yet believe in it. Lord, in your mercy. That all government leaders throughout the world will be blessed with the strength and wisdom they need to carry out their public service so we can all live in peace and harmony. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That government officials and public health officials will be granted understanding and knowledge in their efforts to control the COVID-19 pandemic as the administration of the vaccine to all increases. Lord, in your mercy. That in light of Christ's victory over death, all nations will work together to overcome violence against all, especially the poor, the weak, and the unborn. Lord, in your mercy. That through the grace of the Holy Spirit, all gathered here today and Christians throughout the world will grow ever closer to the risen Lord. Lord, in your mercy. That God will bring the light of his healing and peace to those who are sick and suffering, and those who have asked us to pray for them. Lord, in your mercy. That all who have died, especially those who have died unremembered and unmourned, and Carmela Moyer, Elise Hanlon, Jean Albertini, Ruby Pawanda, and Nadia McCarran, will now share in the promise of new love won for us by the resurrection. Lord, in your mercy. That Clara and John Selinsky, whom we remember in this Mass, will always share in the eternal banquet in heaven. Lord, in your mercy. For those petitions that we hold deep in our hearts. Lord, in your mercy.
God of glory, you know the deepest desires of our hearts. As we celebrate the resurrection, make us faithful to you in all we do. Hear, we ask these prayers we offer today through your Son, Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice of your hands, for the praise and the glory of his name, for our wonderful and holy Church.
Accept, O Lord, we pray, the oblations of your people, that, renewed by confession of your name and by baptism, they may attain unending happiness through Christ our Lord. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, at all times to proclaim you, O Lord, but on this day, above all, to laud you yet more gloriously when Christ our Passover has been sacrificed. For he is the true Lamb who has taken away the sins of the world. By dying, he has destroyed our death, and by rising, he restored our life. Therefore, overcome with paschal joy, every land, every people exalts in your praise, and even the heavenly powers with the angelic hosts sing together the unending hymn of your glory as they acclaim. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread, and giving thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice and once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith. Together with Francis, our Pope, and Alfred, our Bishop, and all the clergy. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Blessed Joseph, her spouse, with the blessed apostles, and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs of eternal life, and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him and with him and in him, You said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you." Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
Peace of the Lord be with you always.
Amen.
Thank you.
My Jesus, I believe that you are present in this most holy sacrament. I love you above all things, and I desire to receive you into my soul. Since I cannot at this moment receive you sacramentally, come at least spiritually to my heart. I embrace you as if you were already there, and unite myself wholly to you. Never permit me to be separated. Let us pray. Grant, we pray, Almighty God, that our reception of this Paschal sacrament may have a continuing effect in our minds and hearts through Christ our Lord. Would you please be seated for a moment? I want to share with you tonight that effective June 15th, this coming June, I will be officially retiring as the pastor here at St. Patrick. So I'll be here 2 more months as pastor, and then of course someone else will be assigned to that responsibility. I just want to let you know that it truly has been a great privilege and honor to be pastor of this very venerable parish. Now, I was thinking about it today. 20 years or more, actually, I'm here 19 this time, of my priesthood has been spent in this parish where I grew up. So I was able to, by God's grace, give back, hopefully, many of the blessings I received growing up here. So I'm looking forward to the next phase of my life. Retirement from being a pastor means simply retirement from administration. I will continue, of course, to be a priest, to be functioning as a priest, to celebrate Mass and sacraments, and be very happy to help out everywhere I can, whenever I can. So I just want to let you know that, and promise you that we will continue to pray for each other, and I know that God has great things in store for the future of the parish. Please stand. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
May Almighty God bless you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Go in peace. Amen.